The Bluebell estate in Huyton is on the surface similar to many other housing estates up and down the country. But a closer look at the past reveals a rich and interesting history steeped in the events of the Second World War. The Bluebell area played host to three different war camps. A transit camp to house military personnel before going off to war. An internment camp to accommodate enemy aliens deemed a potential threat to national security. And a prisoner of war camp. Although there's barely a trace of the camps today, there are many clues to the Bluebell's wartime involvement.
After the war, when these houses were built in the 1950s, 1960s, the council at the time, because of the World War II historical significance, then decided to name all the roads after significant either World War II battles, World War II generals, anything significant in World War II. For example, this here is Horrocks Road. It was General Horrocks who fought in the Far East. Over there we have Ironside Road, which was the nickname for General Ironside. This road here is Salerno Road, which is named after a battle in the Italian campaign, the Battle of Salerno, where a lot of our soldiers died. We have Normandy Road, which was another big battle in the Second World War. Montgomery Road, which our General Montgomery, who led our troops through a lot of the battles and a lot of the campaigns. All the roads have these World War II significances, all of the roads.
This is Jambine Drive.
Many of today's older Bluebell residents were in fact civilian evacuees from Liverpool during the Blitz of 1941. And it's this group of people who've been involved in running and managing a two-year research project into the heritage of the area.
We came to live up in Huyton when I was two, 1940, because we'd been burnt out in Bootle. And my earliest recall is when the planes would go over, and when my dad was home from sea, say, look at them and see the planes going over.
Maybe I was four or five, like when the siren would go off. My mother would get us all, because there was a lot of us. And my brother was the baby, he was younger than me. And he has one of these big gas masks, a big round one, but he put a little new baby in. I'd have the Mickey Mouse thing on my face, and the other kids would. And my brother, and how the hell she got us all in this little box room, I just don't know. Years later, I looked at it and I thought, it's an impossibility, but she did.
I can remember the village when I first moved up here. I thought I'd died and gone to heaven coming up here, you know. All this lovely greenery, and to me it was all fresh air, you know. No smog, no what's name, yeah.
Garden wasn't very big, and once the air raid shelter was in it, there wasn't a lot of room. But I have got a photograph of me digging in the garden, and my mother's actually written on the back, digging for victory. My mother had dressed me up nice. That was the funny thing about it. For this picture to dig in the garden, she'd actually put my best dress on, sort of thing, you know. People used to, you know, they'd grow their own stuff, and we'd, you know, you sort of shared alike and everybody. And my mum's always been a good cook, and there was always somebody knocking on the door for pastry and whatever.
Well, you just shared what you had. You just all shared.
There was a lot of black marketeering going on, you know. There was a little shop, a little cottage next door to the Bluebell, and we called it Three Knocks. And everyone knew it was Three Knocks, so I don't know why they knocked three times to buy cigarettes. They used to sell cigarettes there.
We didn't have many clothes, but fortunately my mum and my gran were all very good with their fingers and sewing machine. For our entertainment on a Saturday night, we used to go to my granny's in front of the fire, and we used to sit cutting any old material up and making pegged rugs. You know?
And the first time I ever saw my father, as I remember, I could have been four or five, and he came into the cottage where we lived, and I was actually standing in the stone sink having a wash. My mother was washing me, and because I got left there, this naked person standing in the sink, and my mother's hugging and kissing, and I haven't a clue who he was.
My father came home from sea. And he said, "Here, I've got something for you. We're sitting down having our tea." And he just come in, and he brought this black thing out about that big, and he said, "Yeah, this is for you, it's a banana." And I'd never seen a banana in my life.
My uncle come up, and he was in the Desert Rats, and he brought bananas in.
And I went, "No, no," and he put it, I screamed, because I thought it was something poisonous.
And I ate the banana with the skin on, because I'd never seen one before.
And I wouldn't eat it, and he peeled it. It was overripe, because it was black, and he ate it. And I was saying, "You'll die, you'll die."
I'm sitting there eating this, and the nurse come running in, you know, like this. And I said, "Oh, you don't eat it all, you know. Why are you wasting the skin? There you see again, why were you wasting the skin?"
Oh, yeah, we could never throw anything away. Everything was so precious, really. And you couldn't afford to buy. And there wasn't anything available anyway.
It was a hard life, and it was, you did without. But what you didn't have, you didn't miss. See, what you didn't have, you didn't miss.
The group organised visits to significant places.
Here we are today in the Eden camp in North Yorkshire. And now this is a World War II prisoner of war camp. This would have been very similar to the one on King George VI fields in Huyton. And the story of the camp is the story of the war. It's so interesting.
I'll get him.
Someone else can get him with me.
Sister, she worked in the factory for the Americans making the donuts, but she brought more home than what she gave the Yanks. Kids never went hungry around by us.
The outings brought the older residents together and gave them a chance to reminisce about their own wartime experiences.
My dad used to say, "You should go, another bomb's dropped, Dad." You know, it was nothing, just you could hear them in the distance.
The incendiary bombs made an awful noise. They whistled and whistled and whistled, and then when they hit the ground, they boom.
After the bombing, we used to come out of our house and stand on the street and watch the docks burning. You could see the docks from where we live, and they were all burning.
We didn't realise it was this bad,
like
if you know what I mean.
Like this to you, all listening here, you realise what was going on.
We felt like if our mum and dad, if we were all safe, well, the war, and you know, they didn't pass on their fear to us. I don't think so, did they?
Oh, no.
No.
My mother didn't seem to be afraid, so she must have been very strong. She never, ever panicked to us and said, "Oh, my God, you know, the planes are coming over like the bombs." She was so relaxed, and she'd do things quickly, and we'd all be stuck in this cupboard, as I said before.
But when you see it on the newsreels and you see what devastation was actually done, it slightly comes home to you, you know. I used to go when the grandma used to take me to the pictures, and he'd have it on the newsreels, you know. She used to take granddad and he'd fall asleep, but we'd just go out and leave him there, you know. But when you see these tanks and you think, well, you know, my Uncle George might be in there. My gran would be crying, you know. It could be our Georgie, you know.
I remember that when he said it. Everyone out in the street shouting.
Yeah,
there
was
loads of bonfires
all
the war's over.
We had a big bonfire and a party, and I've got the photograph taken of all the children and everything, and the grown-ups and the old prams and all that sort of thing. It's just running around wild, as far as I can remember. I don't even remember the tables being in the street.
And someone would have a mouth organ or something, you know, to get the do started. And it was real happy. They'd be ending up dancing in the street, in the road, you know. And us kids would be... I don't know what time we went to bed. I don't think we ever thought about going to bed. But we enjoyed it, yeah.
Oh, now the time to roll out the battle, because the gang's all in.
Children from two primary schools in the area, St Aidan's Catholic Primary School and Huyton with Roby C of E aided primary school, have taken part in a series of visits and trips to explore the Second World War and understand its significance both locally and in a wider context.
And this is where the real controls come from in World War II. And this was a secret place where no one could get found.
It was operational 24 hours a day, and both officers and WAFs accommodated in nearby dormitories would be working in here around the clock.
You could find out where all the ships got blew up. Attacked them with the bomb and it crashed.
See the damage it caused? It sank to over 60 metres, fill up with water.
What is it?
It sank!
Once it had filled up with water, you're able to open the torpedo hatch and swim out. The vessel could travel 12,000 miles, a long, long way, carry 200 tonnes of fuel. It could actually damage the outer hull and it wasn't necessarily sink. It's when it goes through the pressure hull or the inner hull that's when they have problems. And a lot of the lads on board volunteered because the food was so good. Because during the war they didn't have much food, a lot of rationing.
Behind me is the Imperial War Museum, and we've come here today with 40 residents and about 90 school children, and we've come round here as a day to show the children and the adults principally about the history of World War II, which is connection so closely with our project.
We're looking at stuff from World War I and World War II.
We're using the history of World War II to connect the children in the schools and the adults who actually live through it, to make a connection between those generations.
It made me feel like I was in World War II, like we was under the air raid shelter and all that. My mum's dad was in the war.
And Liverpool received a really dreadful damage and bombing. And I don't think people truly realise how much Liverpool and the Liverpool people went through.
Just imagine having a World War III, that would be scary.
When you think the millions of people that died, it's something that we should never forget. And everybody should be taught about it.
It's been a lovely day out, as you can see the sunshine. It's been a lovely day here at the Imperial War Museum. And we're using the Imperial War Museum as another tool to bring the generations together.
Tommy Jockins, a Bluebell resident, was evacuated from Liverpool as a small boy and ended up in the village of Whitworth, Lancashire.
After the May Blitz in 1941, we had to go because we had no house, and they bombed it, so we had to get evacuated. And my mum, my brother and sister, my auntie and her little baby, and my grandmother and granddad, and we all went to Whitworth, Rochdale.
On a recent visit back there, he met up with old friends and officially opened a new playground at the primary school he attended 70 years previously.
Yeah, that's right. All the houses were all bombed around. It's the railway line, and the Germans were trying to bomb the railway line. We were under the railway line as a shelter.
Right.
And they bombed all the houses either side, but never the railway line.
Don't put it. All right, Annette, look at me. I knew what I needed. Is it on video?
down at school. It was brilliant, you know. And I met four of the women that were in the same class as me. Well, I didn't know them, like, but they were in the same class.
I know his name.
He remembered all the people on the picture I had. And he remembered, so we remembered him. Well, I said, that's me. So, you know, that's what he said, you know. So, and they knew everyone on the picture.
Yeah, I'm sure they would, yeah.
After being up here 4 years, your accent must have gone. When you
went
back to Liverpool.
Yeah, I did.
You came back with a Whitworth accent.
I did.
Yeah.
I used to say, on buzz.
On
balls. The house was just here, and it used to drop down at the back. You know, yeah. It was a big drop, and there used to be a landing at the back. Yeah. And there were cellars underneath, because we used to go in the cellars, so as there was grids outside where they put the coal, people used to drop money down there, we used to go and look for it. The Iron Bridge goes across, the trains used to just run along there. We used to climb up and put pennies on the railway line and we used to flatten them. The train, it did, yeah.
Where we stood here is the Wolfhall area of Huyton. These houses were built just at the start of the Second World War. What the government did, they got the Italians, Germans, any foreign nationals, non-English, and these new houses were then had a fence put around them, and the foreign nationals were interned here. This is where they were kept.
The first internees held in the camp arrived on the 17th of May 1940, and at its peak, there were up to 5,000 people in the camp at any one time.
They were all friendly, and everybody was friendly to them. There was no animosity. And the lady at the back of us used to be apple orchards all around from Lord Derby's, and they'd get the apples and they'd all make cakes, big apple pies, because there was no food around, and everybody helped everyone. And even they used to pass them through the wire to the internees.
They had nothing really, and they must have got on each other's nerves, like all living in the same houses, you know, 10 of them. But they had their own the estate, like it was off of the estate. They walked around, you know, and spoke to each other, and someone had passed and they'd wave, and you'd go over and have a chat with them, you know. I suppose they were glad of the company, really, you know, different home, thinking of home, I suppose, you know.
And they'd say, would you go to the shop, there's a corner shop, and you give, you know, get messages for them. But everybody looked at, everybody didn't look at them as bad people.
There's one who was a musician, and he composed, quite ironically, the Huyton Suite while he was based here, in celebration of the fact that he was in Huyton, the Huyton Suite. And now the main civic hall here is called the Huyton Suite.
Yes, I have particular memories about the internment camp, because a friend of the family was there, and that's his photograph. He came over to England from Warsaw as a young man. He was a mentor to me. You know, he'd keep me on, when I was a young girl, he'd keep me on the straight and narrow. And he was an interpreter in the courts. He knew about 12 or 13 languages. And yet, after the years he was in the courts, because he was Polish and because he was a Jew, he was interned. And my father used to take me down to the camp, and he'd pick me up to, so I would stand on the wall, and he'd hold on to me and he'd say, wave to Mr. Luft, give him a wave, and he would wave back. And my daughter was called after his daughter. She is Deborah. And I just loved the bones of that man for what he taught me. Thank you.
By October 1941, all of the internees had left Huyton.
When they were going and they were taking the huts down, I always remember there was four of us and we were standing watching, and he said, "Will you?" One of them said, "We'll sing Lily Marlene," and we were showing the other fellas, and we all tap danced on the hut, you know, it had been taken down, and they all clapped.
If you're Lily Marlene,
The Bluebell camps also brought people to the area from overseas. After being captured by British forces, two young German servicemen, Rolf and Erich, were moved from camp to camp, eventually ending up in a POW camp on Longview Lane.
So you had to have the barrier.
He opened up. That's all become now just plain field, isn't it? We had the East Plain Field there, that was the border. We had goals every Sunday, anyway, football.
Yeah?
Oh, they come from everywhere. We made it nice in the camp. We made it nice for us, you know.
Totally.
That's my hut, the hut, that's my bed. That's
the dad lying on his bed.
We had what we call a canteen, and we had a licensed bar, but only bottle stuff, no draft. But Saturday night, there was a big dance records, you know. And there was more people from outside than from the camp there. They were allowed to come in. Oh, yeah.
Everybody having a good time.
Good old days, eh?
Yes.
Now, in another camp, we knew this one lad, he met a girl or a lady or what outside. She used to bring a suit for him. So he went out in a suit, you know. But somebody from the staff saw this chap. He said, I know that chap. I'm sure he's from the camp. So what we do when he came to count, one of us, the sergeant or whoever came to count us, you see if we were all there, he came into the front. When he left, one of our lads went out of the back and went into the next hut and he got counted again. So they were all there. How many you reckon stayed of us here from the camp?
Well,
about 25, eh? You know, we stayed on.
I'd say about 25 or 30. Most of you were from East Germany.
Oh, yeah. By then I knew that my family was still alive, yeah?
Right.
My mother and father and my sister. But they were living in the East under communist rule. But no way would I go there.
Right.
I mean, it was only a young lad, yeah?
Uh-huh.
So they would have said, come on, we got work for you, but not here, somewhere else. I said, no, I've been in the camp for long enough. No more. That's it, finished.
You wanted freedom.
Well, exactly, yeah.
At the end of the war, they worked on bomb disposal, travelling round the country with the Royal Engineers.
So, obviously, I didn't know where to go. They said, go to the, what we call it, canteen, yeah? They said, people there, they're looking for volunteers for the bomb disposal in Huyton. The seven of us got accepted. Bert Trautmann was one, the ex-Manchester City goalkeeper, yeah?
We worked together with the soldiers in Longview Lane, and we were going to different shops, Manchester docks, Hulham, everywhere, where the bombs were dropped, but still in the ground.
Or wherever.
And that was all recorded by your people, soldiers, wherever, where they are, and they have to come out. But I've been all over the country with the Royal Engineers.
What did you do this at?
That's
with?
Me. I was always playing. I put the Huyton near Liverpool.
Yeah.
Number 5 bomb disposal, you know.
Yeah. What did you make it out of?
What do you call them white flowers, the yellow one? Stuck them in the radiator.
Yeah. Did you? I hope it didn't burn the radiator.
So you've been friends for...
Oh, God.
65, 70
years? About
60
years, yeah.
The project has given the Bluebell residents a chance to share their memories and explore the history of their area. It's also given the young people who've taken part an opportunity to learn about the heritage of the estate and the people who live there, and how the past has shaped their community.
To give the children a feeling for their history, this is their area, it's not particularly ours, they will inherit this area, and to give them a feeling of the history that comes with the area.
Being a part of the Bluebell project has been excellent for our school. The children have found it really enjoyable. So the children obviously live here and we're not really aware of the depth of involvement in their own local area in World War II. And so that's really brought the project alive for them. Meeting up with the community group has helped them to make links into the community, and they've almost become friends now of our school. And so now every time that the members come in, the children are really lively with them. If they see them around, it's really made a difference.
This whole thing about bringing people together within the community and developing that sense of respect and of friendship, which I think has certainly happened throughout the project.
What are we doing here?
Well, this is the launch of the website today, and we've got 120 red, white and blue balloons and 120 children from St Aidan's and from Huyton with Roby. And they're all going to let one of the balloons off with the website details on it, and we're going to see how far they get.
Oh,
and,
beautiful, yeah.
Spread the word, spread the message.
That's good thinking, yeah.
We've actually had to ask permission from air traffic control in Liverpool to let the balloons off so that they know, so it doesn't get in the flight path
in
of any... of any easy jet flights going out to Fuerteventura or anything like that.
Keep the balloons.
Hold on tight, everybody.
Who's gone?
So how about we get them all to bunch together and then let them off?
Know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Keep smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies chase those dark clouds far away. And I will just say hello to the folks that you know. Tell them you won't be long. They'll be happy to know that as I saw you go, you were singing this song. We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.